हेलो एवरीवन, माय नेम इज साहिल एंड वेलकम टू द एथोस, व्हाट इज द राइट थिंग टू बी डन। बेसिकली हियर वी ब्रिंग सम ऑफ द इम्पॉर्टेंट कंसेप्ट्स फ्रॉम द एथिक्स जीएस पेपर नंबर 4 एंड वी डिस्कस देम इनटू द एग्जाम प्रेजेंटेबल मैनर। नाउ लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द टुडेज डिस्कशन। सो टुडे व्हाट वी आर गोइंग टू टेक अप, वी विल बी टेकिंग अप सम ऑफ द की टेक अवेज फ्रॉम द COP26 कॉन्फ्रेंस ऑफ पार्टीज 26 and these related developments we will be seeing under the lens of ethics, under the lens of ethics GS paper number 4. First of all, what will be the importance of this particular topic? This topic will be important into our GS paper number 4. Topic number 1, there is applied ethics that have been given in our syllabus. Within the applied ethics, there is the environmental ethics. So within this environmental ethics, this topic will be important. Secondly, it will be important under the topic number 6, where the ethical issues into the international relation has been mentioned. So into topic 1 and topic 6 of GS4, this discussion will be important. Now let's start with it. First of all, the fundamental question comes that what do we mean by the environmental ethics? So guys, the environmental ethics is a sub branch of applied ethics which concerns with the moral relation between the humans and their non-human counterparts. So the moral relation between the humans, ecology, environment, flora, fauna, all this particular thing comes under the environmental ethics. You can understand the environmental ethics by two of very influential quotes. First, the quote given by Gandhiji. Gandhiji says that the world has enough for everyone's need, but not for everyone's greed. Gandhiji is calling for environmental conservation so that a sustainable development can be called for. So Gandhiji's idea is simply pointing towards the environmental ethics. Moreover, environmental ethics could also be taken or could be understood by one more quote, that is, we do not inherit earth as a legacy from our forefathers, but as a debt from our grandchildren. It is also calling for the restraint on the consumption of the environmental resources, because the environmental resources are a debt that you have taken from your grandchildren. So environmental consumption and the restraint onto that thing has been called for. Now, more academic clarity onto the environmental ethics. So guys, let's understand why the environmental ethics today have become very important thing. So for that particular thing, certain key concepts I will be explaining you first. Number one, the concept of anthropocentrism. Anthropocentrism. See, we know that there were the medieval ages. Into the medieval ages, the humans, they were degraded. The most important thing was the church. After the medieval ages, there was the Renaissance that came. And into the Renaissance, what happened? The focus was given onto the human. The focus was given into the human, and human was called as the center of this universe. Human welfare was called as the most important thing, and therefore the anthropocentrism as a viewpoint became important. Anthropocentrism means that human is the center of this universe and every activity needed to be taken for the welfare of a human, for the welfare of a man. Is it clear? As the time passed, along with anthropocentrism, there also came the notion of supremacism. The notion of supremacism. Now, the supremacism means that the human is not only the center of the welfare, rather the human is also supreme than all other species. And the moment the anthropocentrism and supremacism got combined with each other, what happened? The human started to abuse environment, because everything was existing for the human's well-being. Everything was for the pleasure of human. Flora, fauna, environment, resources, everything got exploited. Is it clear? Now, this exploitation continued. Meanwhile, there were some of the great people who raised about the environmental ethics, but the awareness was not that much. However, what happened? Into the 1970s, there was attitudinal shift that started to come. Actually, in 1970s, two of the very impactful books got published, that is The Silent Spring, and the other was The Population Bomb. Silent Sprint and the Population Bomb. And both of these books actually provided the evidence that how the human impact is altering the environment beyond the redemption, and after 1970s, actually the environmental ethics became a very important thing, and it was provided that now a conscious effort is to be made to conserve the human. Human needs to treat the environment as their moral responsibility. Environment can now not be abused. And in response, what happened? Now, after the 1970s, one more viewpoint came to the fore, that is ecocentrism. Ecocentrism. It was said that now, against the anthropocentrism, we need to have ecocentrism. The environment and ecology needs to be at the center, because if the ecocentrism will be there, then only the human existence is possible. So therefore, the environmental ethics are now to be taken up. Human need to use the environment in a responsible manner. This was the genesis of the environmental ethics. Is it clear? And since 1990s, then UNFCCC and all these protocols, they got started. What it was? It was nothing but giving the centrality to the environmental ethics. So this is the genesis of the environmental ethics, number one. Further moving on. Now, there is one more kind of a dimension that can come onto this particular line, that why environmental ethics is not a luxury but a survival precondition. A direct question could be there. Why it is not a luxury but a survival precondition? We can here give the evidence from the IPCC 6th assessment report. Intergovernmental Panel on the Climate Change released their 6th assessment report just a couple of months back, and certain eye-openers have been given which proves this particular statement. Number one, it has been provided that whatever effort may be taken, the temperature rise will happen beyond 1.5 degrees Celsius before 2040. Around 2035, 2036, 1.5 degrees Celsius temperature rise at the level of, at pre-industrial level will happen. Now, if you remember, in 2015, in the Paris, we have taken a target that we will make every effort and we will try to restrict the temperature rise at 1.5 degrees Celsius. But it will say that 1.5 degrees Celsius to kab tak ho jayega? Before 2040, and by 2050 it will go to 2 degrees Celsius, and by 2100 around 2 to 2.5 degrees Celsius temperature rise can happen. One. Then the other things, it has been provided that basically because of the human induced climate change, heat extremes will increase and the cold extreme will reduce. Heat extremes will increase and the cold extreme will reduce. Thirdly, it has been provided that the countries dependent on to the agriculture, such as the India, they will see the extreme climatic events and the disruption onto the climatic patterns, and the monsoons will be witnessed. Fine. So, environmental ethics today is a survival precondition and not a luxury. We can conclude this particular thing by the findings of the IPCC 6th assessment report. Now, let's discuss what was India's stand pre-COP26 and whether India's stand pre-COP26 was ethically justified under the environmental ethics or not. Okay, so basically guys, before the COP26, India was made two types of request. Request number one, it was said that India should adopt the carbon neutrality. Is it clear? India should adopt the carbon neutrality anywhere around 2050, 2060, 2070. Second thing that was requested to the India is that India should revise their INDC target. Intended nationally determined contributions that were taken after 2015 by all the countries. INDC targets were some of the targets that were taken by countries themselves, that what they will be doing to fight the climate change. Okay. India also took the INDC target. For example, it was said that number one, India will reduce the carbon emission intensity by 33 to 35%
by 2030.
So carbon emission will be reduced by 33 to 35%. Secondly, it was provided that by 2030, the 40% by 2030, by the 40% of the India's installed electricity generation will happen by the renewable sources. And thirdly, it was provided that India will develop 2.5 to 3 billion ton of the additional carbon sink by planting more trees or by other carbon sequestration technologies. So these were the targets that we have taken. Now, the developed countries were insisting the India before the COP26 that you take the carbon neutrality by 2050 and also you revise your INDC targets that you have taken up into the 2015. But India said that no, we cannot do that particular thing. At that point of a time, it was said that India is behaving unethically. India is environmentally irresponsible. Now, into this particular capacity, was India actually unethical? Let's see this particular thing. So guys, India was not unethical before the COP26. What were the ethical justifications that were given by the India? So first of all, ethical justification that was there, the principle of utilitarianism. Now, the principle of utilitarianism talks about the greatest happiness of the greatest number. India provided this particular thing that as per many of the global estimates, India is having an absolute number, a very big population of the poor who are living into the poverty. The hunger is actually a very big problem. We need to bring the growth so that the poverty and the hunger could be tamed. It was provided that for bringing the growth, actually, we need a cheap power source. We need to have a cheap power source. And for that particular thing, the reliance onto the coal cannot be reduced into the coming times, because the growth is needed, poverty is to be removed, hunger is to be removed, and the cheap energy is needed. And it was provided very categorically by one of a report given by the CEEW, that is the Council of the Energy, Environment and Water. It provided this particular thing that if India needs to achieve the carbon neutrality, then 99% of the coal is needed to be phased out between 2050 and 2060. And 90% of the crude oil consumption is needed to be phased out between 2050 to 2060. This was to be done as per the report by the CEEW. We cannot simply phase out the coal. Moreover, it was provided this particular thing that transitioning towards all these kind of a thing will require billions and billions of dollars. This billions and billions of dollars we can actually use to remove the poverty, to remove the hunger, to provide the education, to provide the health to the people which is more needed. So right now, keeping into the principle of utilitarianism, greatest happiness of the greatest number, in order to reduce the poverty, in order to reduce the hunger, we cannot simply go towards adopting these particular kind of targets. So as per this particular principle of utilitarianism, India did not take up the enhanced targets. Second, the principle of the social justice. Now, the social justice, the principle of climate social justice, it provides that everybody needs to be given the fair share of their environmental resources. Environment, even into the emission space, the fair share needs to be given. It was provided that when we see the rich countries, into the rich countries, they have just 12% of the population, but the historical CO2 emissions by them are 50%. Whereas the poor, the other countries, they have 88% of the population, but their emission are just 48%. It is inequity that is there. It was provided that if you see the per capita emission, then onto the per capita emission, actually India's per capita emission are one of the lowest into the world. So as per the principle of the social justice also, it was said that India need to be given their fair share. So therefore, any extra targets should not be taken by the India. Thirdly, it was said that there is a principle of CBDR, common but differentiated responsibility. It provides that actually everyone has a responsibility into the direction of taking efforts for the climate change, but the rich countries, they have more responsibility. Responsibility is common but differentiated, and differentiated means that the rich countries, they have more responsibility. So they needed to first take the enhanced target and then we will taking it up. So because of these particular principles, India did not took any stand. Okay. However, what India actually did when we went to the COP, and under the lens of ethics, what are the implications of it? So guys, when India actually went to the COP, what India did? India adopted the Panch Amrit. India adopted the Panch Amrit, where the five targets were revised by India. Okay, India said that, okay, we are revising targets. It was not official revision of INDC, but India said that, okay, for our own purpose, our domestic targets, at our own initiative, we are revising. What they said? Non-fossil energy capacity will be taken to 500 gigawatt by 2030. Earlier it was 450 to 500. Then it was said that net zero we will be adopting by 2070. Third, 50% of energy requirement will be coming by renewable by 2030. It was 40%. Carbon emission, okay, projected carbon emission will be reduced by 1 billion ton. Is that clear? 1 billion ton carbon emissions will be reduced by 2030. Then it was provided that the carbon intensity will be reduced to less than 45%. Clear? So basically India itself revised these kind of a target, and India actually proved to be environmentally more responsible and environmentally more ethical. So the Panch Amrit actually showcased the India's ethical attitude, ethical responsibility towards this pressing issue. What are the implications? Let's understand it. Number one, it shows that India has switched to the deontological approach. That deontological approach pertains where you focus more on your duty. You focus more onto the way of doing the things. The way becomes more important. Now, earlier also India was doing much. According to a report by the climate tracker, India was overachieving their INDC. But now, in order to take more of a responsible way, to show more responsible way, what India had done? India had changed their viewpoint, and now the deontological approach, where India is taking more just way, more of enhanced duty, it is reflected. Then the second thing, message of ethical altruism has been given. What is altruism? Putting yourself at a discomfort, but making sure that the other people's welfare happen. So basically, India might put itself into the pain because the carbon neutrality has been taken by 2070. I told you, as per CEW, the coal is to be phased out, the crude oil is to be phased out. India had to invest more, India had to work even more hard, but for the sake of collective well-being, upholding the value of Vasudeva Kutumbakam, this altruism India had taken, and it shows the moral aspect of India's response here. Next, we have reaffirmed the Gandhian environmentalism. What Gandhiji said, that the world has enough for everybody's need, but for not everybody's greed. We are now using the environmental resources even in more responsible manner, even in more sustainable manner. So the Gandhian environmentalism has been reaffirmed by the India. Then the next thing, compassion for island nations. India came out with the IRIS. Fine. Infrastructure Resilience Initiative for the Island States. Okay, IRIS. Into the IRIS, what we will be doing? We will be sharing the technical know-how, we will be sharing the best practices with the island nations so that they can make their infrastructure resilient to the disasters. Okay, infrastructure resilience into the island states. We will teach them how to make your infrastructure resilient from disasters, because now as the climate change will be coming, more disasters such as the tsunami, cyclone will be coming. So we will be building the capability into the island nation, number one, by the IRIS initiative that has been taken by India here. Secondly, when the sea level will be rising, the island nations will be more impacted. They might submerge. And in order to protect the island nation, India had taken the Panch Amrit, and India might be putting itself into the pain, but the compassion for the island nations have been shown so that their survival doesn't get impacted. Is it clear? So basically, all these kind of things have been done, and this shows the moral uprightness of India. And finally, a moral symbolism has been basically showcased by the India. A moral symbolism, a moral messaging has been given by the India, that though the principle of CBDR is there, common but differentiated responsibility, though there is the climate justice that is there, okay, but still we are enhancing our targets, because this is a symbolism and the developed countries should learn from this particular thing. So the moral symbolism has also been reflected by the India here, okay. So basically into all these particular kind of things we can see that how India had showcased their ethical uprightness into all these particular kind of developments. And this is the key takeaways from COP26 under the ethical lens. Fine guys, I hope that you have understood this particular issue, and I hope that if any question on environmental ethics will be coming, you can handle it in a better way. In fact, already a question onto the environmental ethics have been asked, so you need to keep this particular thing into your mind. So that is all about this particular discussion. That is all. Thank you so much.